Good evening, everyone. How are y'all doing today? I hope that y'all are doing well. I am trying to get myself out of a rut. Oh my goodness, y'all. I'm trying to get myself out of a rut. And I don't know, I do. I know why I'm in a rut, but I don't understand why I'm in a rut, if that makes sense. It's like you've got so much to be thankful for, but you know, this sudden bout of depression and anxiety comes over you, and you begin to worry about things that make no sense. And then you're like, where is all of this coming from? And it's like everything I see on TV, I end up dreaming about it. And I don't like that, you know, because it comes out weird in the dream. And I feel like, you know, I'm about to explode. And I know what I need to do. I need to go to Ocean City. I need to get out. I need to do some things. And I need to have a really good cry. Living with depression is, you know, you think you're doing really good at one moment. And then all of a sudden, you know, you're not doing so good. And it's been rough. But then again, I'm always like this in the summer. I've shared with you guys before, I get the summer blues, you know. So I'm hanging in there, and I want to thank you all for, you know, supporting me. Regardless, I am so grateful for that. And so anyway, with that being said, life chat, you know. Gary and I are still fasting, sometimes 16, 17, 18 hours a day, sometimes just 12 hours a day. But we've been keeping that going, and I'm really proud of that. For the most part, I've been just eating, lean meats, vegetables, little organic potatoes, trying to eat everything balanced and in moderation, and eating things that I know that would be pleasing to the Lord and beneficial to my body. I did have a setback, but it was just like I ate orange chicken, a little bit of orange chicken from a Chinese place. And I'm gotten to a place now where I'm starting to get tired of eating chicken soup every day, you know, homemade chicken soup every day with chicken breast and broth and veggies. You know, I'm getting sick and tired of eggs and sausage or eggs and bacon, you know, for my first meal every time I eat. And then there's been a couple of days where once I got up, you know, I work out. I do my little workout, if you want to call it that. I have my elliptical time and my soul time, you know, for that 20 minutes. And then when I'm done, I'm exhausted, and that's really not cool with me. And, you know, and so by the time I done bathe or what have you, I'm exhausted. I got to take a nap. And then, you know, I feel unproductive. And, you know, but it's not enough. One minute it looks like I might have lost some weight, and next minute it looks like I didn't lose any weight. So I'm like not focusing on that. I'm just focusing on doing better and living better. And if weight loss comes, it comes. If it doesn't, it doesn't. So I did go in and try on some clothes and try on some jewelry, things that I hadn't worn in a while, to see if I felt or saw a difference, you know. I'm disappointed in myself for not eating better. It's hard. It's extremely hard because you get so tired of eating the same things every single day. You know, instead of door dashing fast food, I'm door dashing groceries. I had been craving McDonald's hamburgers. And so what I decided to do was I ordered groceries and I got organic 90% lean grass-fed ground beef. And I made my own hamburgers and I bought 647 bread, the keto bread. And I used vegan cheese and I used minced onions and I made my own McDonald's hamburger and it didn't do anything for me because it wasn't McDonald's. It didn't have the McDonald's taste. It was a homemade burger, but at least it was a burger, right? And I had the Alexia fries that you put in your air fryer. So, you know, I had a really, really healthy version of something unhealthy and I was really proud of myself, you know, but, again, it's still down to how many calories, how many carbs, you know, that you're eating, you know, even if it is really the healthier choice. We've been going to bed early a lot. You know, we haven't been staying up very late, so I'm not getting as much done because I'm, you know, going to bed earlier and so forth. Let's see, what else is going on? As far as my husband is concerned, all of you who know Gary, he finally went to see the urologist. Yes, he finally went to see the urologist. I couldn't believe it. The day had finally come. And so he is on prostate medication and he has two exams that he has to have this month. So he has to get a scan, then he has to get another test done so that we can find out what's going on. You know, why is there just like constantly, you know, blood in his urine, you know, every day, all the time, you know? So at least we're headed in the right direction with that. And as far as Gappy is concerned, I took her to get her follow-up exam. I know a lot of you have been asking about Gappy and that means the world to me. Gappy, the tumor, her cancer, the tumor has shrunk. It's shrunk a great deal. In my opinion, I would say that, just to give you an idea, I would say that it went from being the size of a golf ball to the size of, let's say, an M&M with a peanut in it. But when she went and when she was examined, they found that she had another tumor that was deep down. And if it grows, it is going to, it'll smother her. She won't be able to breathe. It's going to crush her lungs. Let's just put it that way. But both tumors have shrunk, but they are there and they can only be removed surgically. So Gappy has to continue to take steroids every day, along with her thyroid medication. She got blood drawn today, so we will find out tomorrow, hopefully, if her thyroid has improved. She didn't gain any weight, yay, but she has a good appetite. She pees a lot. She was constipated. Now she's going to the bathroom regularly. So, you know, I was really optimistic. But the doctor said, you got to remember Gappy is 18 years old and most cats don't even make it to 19, rarely 20. So, with that being said, she's like, I said, okay, well then give it to me straight. Give me an expiration date. Do you have an expiration date? She said, at this moment, I don't have an expiration date. But my goal is to just buy her as much time as I can. And if we can keep these tumors under control, keep them from growing, slow down the rate that they're growing, whatever. That is the important thing, you know. She said that she is hoping that Gappy will live to see the holidays. And I know she meant like Thanksgiving, Christmas. So I said, well, just give me a little bit more of a figure. She said from between 2 to 6 months. That's what she said. So we came on home. I went past McDonald's. Yay! Did not stop in. And I talked to my husband about it, and we just bust out crying. It was crazy. We just started crying about everything. You know, it was coming out. And I just said, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing this. I'm not doing this. Crying is not going to change anything. I'm not doing this. And he's like, but we need this. We need to let it out. And I'm like, I know, but I need to stop. You know, and so I made myself stop crying. You know, so he made himself stop crying. And I said, we've got nothing to cry about. Okay. I said, if God takes Gappy home, you know, after we've mourned a little bit and got ourselves together, we're headed down to the ocean and we're going to start doing a little bit of living, you know? And I have no regrets. That's the good thing. Gappy sleeps beside me, like right beside me. and she's under the covers and we're sharing a pillow together, you know? So I'm having some incredibly beautiful moments with her. You know, she's running around the house more. I bought her some more toys. You know, I'm doing everything. Look, Gappy's had a good life and she's got a good life. You know, she's queen bee, you know, here, you know, and she eats. We give her whatever she wants to eat that, you know, we know it within reason, of course. So, I mean, you know, it's great. I mean, her litter box is in my bathroom so we can be on the john together. If I come in to pee, she's coming in too. You know, it's crazy, but it's a great relationship. And, you know, she's everything. She's everything. And I'm just grateful for the wonderful 18 years that I've had with her. You know, I've had her ever since she was a baby. I nursed her, you know, with the baby medicine, baby milk and stuff. So, I mean, you know, she's a part of me. She is literally a part of me. So I definitely have no regrets. If whenever Jesus wants to take her home, he can. I just want her to go smoothly. You know, she may not even pass away from the cancer, guys. She may just pass away in her sleep because of her age, you know, and that's fine. You know, that's what I want, you know. I want her to have a smooth transition out of here. So that's it for my life update. I want to thank you all for caring. I want to thank you all for all of your comments and your support. It means everything. I mean, it means everything. So we are now in August, and I am going to jump into a little devotional for the month of August. I don't know about you guys, but I need it. I need it. So let's go ahead and open up in here. I feel bad that I haven't been reading through this lately, but I need to take time to, you know, I haven't even finished filling this out. And if you guys know, I've had this, what, for over a year, maybe 2 years. this was like my very first Planner Perfect purchase. So that was maybe 2 years ago, I'm thinking. And look at that. And I never finished it. I started and I never finished. But I like the fact that it's here. Whenever I want to put in scripture and prayers, it's here. You know, it's decorated all that I'm going to do. Yeah, so this is really, really old. But anywho, let us get into this. So I'm just going to do my little thing here and let the Lord just lead where we end up. And what does this say? don't know, didn't we do this already? A divine encounter with in prayer. I think we did this. Yeah, we did. So let's try something else. Let's see. Let's do August first. All right, a divine encounter with grace. All right, I put this in here. Oh, isn't that beautiful? I love that. And I can't wait to write in it. Happiness is everything in life. I think that's what I'm going to do. Since I could easily go, you know, flip through and hit something that I've already hit, and I didn't pray first. You know, I probably should have prayed first, you know, but I'm just going to probably, I think, just stick with whatever the date is. That I think that might be the best idea. So I'll try and do it that way and see what happens. But anyway, August 1st, it says the infusion of God's grace. Let me make sure that you guys are in frame. Yep. All right. So if this is, if you need to zoom in, go down a little further. Let me check and see if I can go down a little further so we can read this together. All right, hold on. Hold on 1 second. 1 second. All right. Whew, my knees are killing me, y'all. Oh my goodness, my knees are killing me. All right, so let's go ahead with this. The infusion of God's grace. Scripture reading is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 through 10. And it says our key verse is Romans 6 and 4. It says here, we were buried with him through baptism into death. That just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. And that's Romans 6 and 4. I would love to go grab my Bible and just get Ephesians and read chapter 2, 8 through 10. But let's see what we got. Let's see how this goes first. Okay, you cannot come to Jesus apart from the grace of God. If you could save yourself, then there would be no need for a Savior. But God's pattern for salvation includes the infusion of his grace in the lives of those who come to him. Grace is all important to the believer. It is God's personal touch, his handprint of intimacy in your life. It is the evidence of his advent and the one thing that keeps you founded in his abiding love. His grace breathes potential into all that you do and say. And the Apostle Paul told us, by grace we have been saved and raised up with him in order that the ages to come he might show the surprising riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. And that is Ephesians 2 verses 5 through 7, and that's the NASB. Okay, he reminded us that we have been buried with Jesus through baptism and into death, so that as Christ was risen from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. The mission of grace did not end at the cross. It overflows into every area of our lives, filling us with hope and the blessed assurance that we are loved with an eternal love. Thus, God has called us to be distributors of his grace to others, just as it has been given to you. So let grace motivate you to give it away to someone today. God, we thank you for your grace that fills us, and help us to give it away to someone today. I love that, y'all, because you know what? You don't know how much time you have left. and you don't want to leave this place, you know, with unresolved things, you know, and people that are in your life that get on your nerves, people that piss you off, whatever the situation might be. Take time to be kind to someone. I mean, not the cliche kind. I mean, seriously, you know, if there's someone that, you know, you feel that you need to forgive, or if there's someone that you feel that you might have been a little bit nasty to, whatever, or someone who may have needed help and you may not really want to help them or whatever, any and every opportunity that you have to show kindness and grace to someone, even if they're not even, especially if they're not deserving of it, it is the most powerful thing you could, one of the most powerful things you can do in the spirit, you know, because we all need it. We are all looking for a savior. We're just, a lot of us, looking in the wrong places. When it boils down to it, we're all looking for a savior. We're all looking to be loved. We're all looking to be accepted. We're all looking to get praised for something. We're all looking to be appreciated, you know, and grace provides all of that. And it doesn't matter if we're deserving of it or not. When someone has grace and gives you that grace, you know, it puts you in a better mood. It makes you happy. It makes you happy when someone goes a little bit out of their way to be kinder to you, you know. Well, of course, unless they're overstepping their bounds or they're just, getting on your nerves because they're being annoying. But the gist of what I'm saying is the same grace that we get from God, we need to extend to other people, especially now when there's so much hatred and so much chaos and so much unforgiveness. Right now is the time. And you don't even have to do it for them. Just do it because you love Jesus. Just do it because you love God. Just do it because you know deep down in your heart that it's the right thing to do. And you will be blessed. You will be blessed. So August the 2nd, we're going to go into that, right? A proper perspective. Scripture reading is Luke 15, 11-32. Key verse is John 1 and 12. As many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. You've probably heard and read Jesus' parable of the prodigal son many times. And the emphasis of the lesson is usually on the wayward brother, right? So no matter how badly he had behaved, and no matter how much he did not deserve his father's forgiveness, he received it anyway. The one often overlooked is the other brother grumbling in the corner, you know, while the party is in full swing. Many of us, if we're honest, secretly identify with him. It just doesn't seem fair. There he was, faithful, obedient, all those years. And the bad seed gets showered with attention just because he did something good for once? Oh yeah. Jesus was pointing out that both brothers were accepted into the same grace. The good brother did not realize it, but he was surrounded by the same unconditional love. My child, you have always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. The steady brother had simply lost his perspective and become mired in a hidden attitude of self-righteousness and pride. You can rejoice when someone trapped in sin is welcomed into the Father's arms. Remember, you were no better when he embraced you with forgiveness. So it should remind you of your own homecoming and fill you with an eagerness to share the delights of belonging with the Father. God, we are so thankful that you are our Father, and we can never lose your eternal love. Oh man, I would love to go grab my Bible, like seriously, and jump into this story, because I understand. Don't you understand how he felt? He felt jealous. He felt hurt. He felt unworthy. He felt left out. Why do we do some of the things that we do, y'all? Who wants to have that feeling of being left out? So, you know, we go and we do things that we would not normally do just to keep from being left out, because we want to feel a part of the party instead of being a wallflower. I heard one lady say that she buys so many stickers because she feels that every time something comes out, if she doesn't buy it, she's going to be left behind. Everybody else is buying it and they're doing their spreads, and I didn't buy it and I feel left out. And it's like, so I got to go buy it. Now I've got all these stickers that I don't know what to do with because I didn't want to feel left out. I can't remember who she was, but that can go across the board for all of us in all areas of our lives. And I can tell you personally, growing up the way that I did, I was left out all the time, like literally all of the time. I was always the one that was against the wall, that's in the corner, that watched other people have their fun and watch other people be celebrated. And I, you know, after a while, come on now, you get tired of celebrating other people's victories. You're like, when am I going to get a victory? When am I going to get noticed? When am I going to get appreciated for what I did? You know, I can go on and on this kind of topic because I've been on both sides. And it hurts. It hurts as a human being. But like he said, Charles Stanley said, there are times when we need to be like, you know what? I feel this, and I'm happy for you. I am happy that you are back into the Father's grasp. I'm glad that you found your way back home, you know? And I want to celebrate and rejoice with you, because this is a powerful thing. But when it happens a little bit too often in your life, and you start to see a pattern, then you're going to start feeling that left out, lonely, hurt thing. Like nobody cares about you, or what you do isn't important. You know, some of the most insane sibling rivalries have been because of stuff like that. You know, so it's so, so, so important that, of course, we're going to feel these things because it is the human experience. But it's how we handle them, how we deal with them, and how we get our perspective right. Because it is so, so easy to lose that right perspective. It is very easy, because we love ourselves, because we have emotions, we have needs that need to be met. You know, with husbands and wives, sisters and brothers, friends, co-workers. And nowadays, if you don't treat people with grace and kindness, if you don't welcome people or make people feel a part of the clique, or a part of the family, or a part of whatever, people flip out on you. People flip out on you. They'll do rotten things to you. They'll do little mischievous things. They'll do little things, you know, envious things, where they do sneaky things behind your back against you because, you know, they feel left out. They feel like they don't matter as much, or you get all the attention. I know there's a cartoon where a little boy had wished something bad to happen to the other boy because the other boy was the leader of their group. And he was like, I never get to lead. You know, I'm tired of following all the time. And, he like wished that something bad would happen to the other boy so that he could lead, you know, and lo and behold, something bad did happen to the boy. And then he felt guilty, and he ended up confessing that little thing to him. And he was like, you know what, if that's how you felt, you should have told me. I would let you lead anytime. But nobody wants to come out and say, I'm feeling insignificant. you know, can I lead our little group? It makes you look weak and wimpy. So that's why he kept it hidden in his heart. Instead, he decided to wish something bad so that way he could just naturally be given that leadership in their group. So, you know, guys, it's a hard thing, and I could literally like preach on it. But do your best to extend grace to other people. And remember not to look for it back, but when you get it back, because God gave it that way. You know, what you give and what you put out will always come back to you in some form or fashion. So be mindful of that. And when those feelings of inadequacy come about, or you feel left out, just remember, you're not left out. You're not left out. Everyone gets their time to shine, and you will get your time to shine. It may not happen when you want it or how you want it, but it always will come around. Sooner or later, you will get the recognition that you deserve. And if you don't get the recognition that you believe that you deserve, believe me, if no one else sees you, God sees you. And whatever reward that you did not get here on earth, you will get that 100-fold in heaven. And you can believe that, because that is God's word. What he has in store for us is far beyond anything that we could even begin to comprehend or even imagine. No ear, no eye, no mind has heard, seen, or conceived what God has for those who love him. So we got to keep our perspective on that right course. And when it falls off, the Holy Spirit will be there to guide us and to let us know, hey, you got to talk to your flesh. David did it. Hey, why are you carrying on like this? Calm yourself down. You know better than this. You know, I have to do it. We all have to do it from time to time with something in our life, you know, and from little things to big things, you know. So remember just how important it is for you to keep that proper perspective and to know and remember the truth of God and his love. God has enough room that he can love each and every one of us, and we will feel his love individually. We never have to feel, you know, that jealousy that he was feeling, because the love that God has for us is for us. And when he gives us his attention, it's like there's nobody else in the world but us. That's how great he is. That's how powerful he is. So when you find yourself over in the corner grumbling about, you know, this, that, and the other, and, you know, in situations of this nature, just remember that everything that God has for you is for you, and you will get it in due season. So chin up, cheer up, and remember that God loves you, and he sees you, and he feels you, and he experiences you. And the love that he has for you, no match. No match. It's all for you, and you will get what is yours in due season. And it will most likely be when you least expect it, because that's how God is. So if you get some time today, jump in and read Luke chapter 15. Forget the 11 through 32, read Luke 15. And even read the first chapter of John. And just get on into it and let that word resonate in you, and just get into your spirit. And when you're done, you're going to feel better. That's how it is for me. That's how it is. Whenever I really feed my soul, have that real good soul time and nourish that spirit, you know, because, you know, your mind needs to be nourished. Your spirit needs to be nourished, just like your flesh needs to be nourished. All three of y'all living in there together, you know, so you got to work that thing out, and you got to work it out together. So I would like y'all to be encouraged. I would like to thank y'all so much for being with me. And I will see y'all in the very next video, which will be very soon. Bye.